So we find this story in Matthew 19, beginning at verse 16. The title to it is The Rich Young Man. And behold, a man came up to him, saying, Teacher, what good deed must I do to have eternal life? And he said to him, Why do you ask me about what is good? There is only one who is good. If you would enter life, keep the commandments. He said to him, Which ones? Jesus said to him, You shall not murder, you shall not commit adultery, you shall not steal, you shall not bear false witness. Honor your father and mother, and you shall love your neighbor as yourself. The young man said to him, All these I have kept. What do I still lack? Jesus said to him, If you would be perfect, go and sell your possessions and give to the poor, and you will have treasures in heaven. And come, follow me. When the young man heard this, he went away sorrowful, for he had great possessions. And Jesus said to his disciples, Truly I say to you, only with great difficulty will the rich person enter the kingdom of heaven. Again I tell you, it is easier for a camel to go through the eye of a needle than for a rich person to enter the kingdom of God. Of course, this is this... Oh, Mark's pointing at a mic. There. Okay.
Thank you.
Now that's family, right? You just walk up to the pulpit, steal the preacher's water, and then go. Okay. The story of the rich young man. A man who has it all. A man who has things working for him. He probably, because he's young, he probably inherited it, or he's very aggressive in what he does, or very good at what he does. And as we read this, we kind of come under the impression that he looks at the things he has as possessions. He owns them. He bought them. He attained them. Maybe he worked very hard to get them where he is. He hears of someone new in town. And this new guy is offering something that somehow he knows he doesn't have. Something he doesn't own, called eternal life. So we pick it up in verse 16, and behold, a man came to him saying, Teacher, what good deed must I do to have eternal life? You know, it's a simple question. What will this cost me to have eternal life? What do I need to give up? Literally, the translation of eternal life, the literal translation is a full, permanent relationship with God. Isn't that interesting? Full and permanent. He has spent his life so far in search of gold. And now there's something else out there that he wants. You see, I believe that he has, even though he doesn't know what it is, I believe he has a great hole in the middle of him. And he's looking for something that can fill it. And the world can't fill it. I think that's what Jesus is talking about, and I don't know where throughout this week we talked about this, but my peace I give you, I do not give as the world gives. He gives us something that doesn't take away the difficulties in life. He gives us something that we can hang on to in the middle of it. And so, somehow, this rich young man knows that there's a void in the middle of him somewhere. And this is going to fill it. So he comes right out and asks, what will it cost me? Not a bad question. Do you ever feel like this? What do I need to do? What do I need to do next? What do I need to do to maintain my relationship with God? What will it cost me? Searching for something that everyone wants. And at that time, there's a big group of people following Jesus. So, you know, Simon Peter, there's an interesting statement that Simon Peter makes. At one point, Jesus is talking to his disciples, talking to the followers. There's a whole group of them following him now. And he says a statement that makes it very hard for some of them to understand, and a whole bunch of them leave. And Jesus looks at his 12 and he says, Are you going to leave me too? And Simon Peter responds this way, Lord, to whom shall we go? You have the words of eternal life. Wow. So is it words? Or is it actions that are invoked by these words? He's saying, this young man is saying, I know, for some reason, I know I need this. And I believe it's because his soul is crying out for it. But his flesh is weighing the cost. He's searching for truth, but he's being cautious. So in verse 17, Jesus answers, and he said to him, why do you ask me about what is good? There is only one who is good. If you would enter life, keep the commandments. So Jesus' answer may sound like he isn't taking the question seriously, but believe me, he always takes that question seriously. What do I need to do, God, to get right with you? Is really the question, right? And so he always takes it seriously. But his answer is basically saying, follow the teachings that you already know. Obviously, this guy is a Jew, or Jesus wouldn't have said that to him. And they had the rules. They had the laws of Moses. They had the commandments. They had the history. They had the stories. They had the miracles. All the miracles that were performed through the Old Testament and the Bible happened to the nation of Israel. And if you weren't on that team, you were on the losing team. And you know, when they left Israel, they're a bunch of ragtag slaves that had been building pyramids and castles for years and bricks. And they defeated the most feared army in the world. It wasn't because of what they did. All they did was walk away. Through the door God opened and God closed it. So whenever you read, especially if you read it outside the Bible and read it in that era of history, they feared the God of Israel. And so feared the people of Israel. Feared the Israelites because of their God. So obviously this man knew about the commandments, or Jesus wouldn't have said, just follow the rules. You know the rules. This is how they were taught to read and write, was to read the law of Moses. What we call the first five books of the Bible. The Pentateuch? Yeah. Never can pronounce that word right. Anyway, they're told to follow the first five books of the Bible, really. And the rules are in there. So in verse 18 and 19, he said to him, which ones? And Jesus said, you shall not murder, you shall not commit adultery, you shall not steal, you shall not bear false witness. Honor your father and mother, and you shall love your neighbors yourself. The way he asked the question is understandable because the Jewish leaders had taken the Ten Commandments and had wrapped them up in all these different rules and regulations to try and protect the commandment. It was like they were building things around the commandment. Like, thou shalt not keep the Sabbath day holy. And they figured out how many steps it was before it was considered work. Because you weren't supposed to work on the Sabbath. So you could only go so many steps from your home. Like, it got really complicated. And so it comes to understand which ones. Because, like, there's 600 and some now. And Jesus really takes it back to basics. Don't murder. Don't commit adultery. Don't steal. Don't lie. Listen to your mom and dad. Love your neighbor. Pretty simple stuff. The young man said to him in verse 20, all these I have kept. What do I still lack? And that blows me away. I find it more than interesting that even though he had followed those rules his whole life, he knows he doesn't have it. Because he says to Jesus, what do I do? And Jesus says, do that. And he goes, well, I've already done that. Peace out. I'm good. No. He says, there's still something that's not right. And that amazes me. He knows there's a void. I believe this is because salvation brings a feeling that cannot be faked. Amen. You can't fake salvation. It brings a feeling in you that is real. So in verse 21, Jesus said to him, if you would be perfect, go and sell what you possess and give to the poor, and you will have treasures in heaven, and come follow me. People get freaked out when you read that. John Schulman says, it's because you're touching the most sensitive nerve in the human body, the wallet. But I'd like to point out, he doesn't say sell, in this one here, he doesn't say, and this is, I use an English Standard Version, and the reason I use the English Standard Version is most commentators that have read the older stuff and have studied say it is one of the most accurate ones. And in this one, it doesn't say, if you would be perfect, sell all you possess. Just sell what you possess. Like, take some of your luxury and spend that on somebody else. And I have to say, this church is real good at that. Mm-hmm. This church blesses people.
Amen.
And you know, we gave over $1,000 to Tammy Hudson, and we gave over $1,000 to that family that lost their home in a fire. That's amazing. So, but it's not about money. He's saying, get rid of your old God and make me your new God. That's what he's saying. Like, look at this young man's life. He is fixed and focused on money. It says he had a whole bunch of possessions. So that has been his focus. It has very little to do with bank balance. It's more about what's on the throne of your heart. What do you think when you hear those words? I find it interesting, and we'll talk about it later. The last four words we don't really look at, but we're going to look at them today. So in verse 23 and 24, it says, and Jesus said to his disciples, truly I say to you, only with great difficulty will a rich person enter the kingdom of heaven. Again, I tell you, it is easier for a camel to go through the eye of a needle than for a rich person to enter the kingdom of heaven. Many people hear this and think if you have too much money, then you can never find salvation. But you see what Jesus is saying, surrender the things of your heart. And there is a story out there that there was a crack in the wall of Jerusalem, and that if you didn't want to go around the city, that you could walk through, and if your camel, if you unloaded the camel would get down on its haunches and could go through this thing, and they call it the eye of the needle. There's no evidence of that being true. Okay? And so you say to me, well, the camel can't go through the eye of the needle. Anything is possible with God. And the idea is not to get the camel through the eye of the needle. The idea is to take out of your richness and bless somebody else. That's the goal. We're not trying to shove a camel through the eye of a needle. We're trying to get into heaven. And it's saying if you've been blessed with financial health, use it to bless somebody else. That's all he's really saying. Jesus knew what this man loved the most in this world. And he was asking him, are you willing to replace it with something else? Are you willing to replace it with me? Jesus saw that his love for money. And the last part of that, he says, if you would be perfect, go sell what you possess, give to the poor, you have treasures in heaven, and come follow me. We don't really talk about that too much. Come follow me. Where I lost my place. Sorry. Follow me. The man's actions had proved that Jesus was right. When the young man heard this, he went away sorrowful, for he had great possessions. He was not happy because Jesus had just given him the truth of eternal life. He had given him the keys to heaven. He was upset because he would have to give up what he truly loved. His possessions were on the throne of his heart, not Christ. If anything is on the throne of our heart other than God, there's no room for God. He says very clearly that he is a jealous God. We've been talking about that. In our study of Revelation, we're talking about, we're up into chapter 13 and 14 and 15, and we're talking about the deception of man. And we're talking about how Satan's goal, if you read in Revelation and you study Revelation, you realize that his goal is to deceive man into worshiping the devil. And so, when we were studying it, you know, we talked about he's trying to get them to break the first and second commandment. And it's interesting that Jesus says follow the commandments. But the devil's trying to get man in Revelation to follow, break the first and second commandments. But before he gives the commandments, he opens with this line. For you shall worship no other God, your Lord, whose name is jealous, is a jealous God. Don't make God mad. If there is something that means more to you than me, God is saying, if there is something that means more to you than me, you don't have room for me. This message is not just for them, nor is it all about money. It's here and it's now. And it's about our hearts. We can love many things more than God, not even realize it. Of course, there's the obvious ones. I get the Journal de Montréal every morning. I know that's kind of weird because in English, but I started getting the Journal de Montréal when I was studying for nursing. I had to pass that French exam, and it improved my French. And as I started reading it, I realized I like the news better than the Gazette, because it's more local and it's more about what's going on here. And so I let my subscription run out, and then I just redid it again. I said, no, I miss it. And the other day I was reading, the actually it was in the Gleaner, wasn't it? It was a guy that owned 40 cars? No, it was in the Journal de Montréal. This guy owned 40 cars, because that's what I put first, cars. Guy owned 40 cars. Millions of dollars invested in cars. What do you think his love is?
40 million.
40 million. Yeah, you read that. You get the Journal every day. $40 million he had vested in cars.
Wow.
Really? We went out car shopping this week. That's a scary deal. And I'm thrilled to get a new car coming, but not my God. And you'll never make a poorer investment than a car. Anything that you buy loses $10,000 as soon as you drive it out of the parking lot. Not really a good investment. But anyway, this guy, because there's things that are bad that we can pick, like cars or homes or drugs or alcohol or sex or money. And of course, they're bad and everybody can see them and spot them. But there are things that are, but not all things are bad. Some of them are good things. Food.
Getting smaller.
Food, family, friends, music, ministry, church. Well, how can church be bad? It's not. It's not a bad thing. Friends is not a bad thing. Family's not a bad thing. Music's not a bad thing. But when we put that before God, when Brendan and I first came to Christ, my family intentionally organized everything they did Sunday mornings. Or at least that's how I felt. Oh, we're going out for breakfast. My family never went out for breakfast. My family had coffee and cigarettes for breakfast, and all of a sudden we're going to restaurants for breakfast on Sunday morning. And so after about a year and a half of us not being there, they realized, okay, but I could have very easily, I wasn't the preacher then. Nobody would have really missed me. Nothing wrong with doing it every once in a while, but my family seemed to be doing it quite often. There's nothing wrong with family. Family is a blessing. Love my family dearly. Glad that my family's getting bigger. Thrilled by it. When they called me and I wanted to talk to Holly, I had to stop because I was crying. I'm so happy. I'm thrilled by that. But that's not my God. Food. Like, I'm trying to learn to live, eat to live, not live to eat. find out that balance? Friends are great. But friends are not my God. These are good things. We need them. But we need to have a balance with them. The question is, do you love them in your heart more than God? And would you choose them over God's direction for your life? The choice is not so easy sometimes when we get into that. When we say, church is more important than God. And you know what? You may not see it, but I see that happening every day. Because when the church building is more important than the people God has given you to minister, there's a problem. And if this church burns down this week, we'll meet next week at the picnic tables, and then we'll figure out something else in Normstown. Because this is not the church. We are the church. We're the family. So my question, I guess I have a bunch of questions. What's on the throne of your heart? I keep saying, God loves you, God loves you, God loves you. What's on the throne of your heart that's maybe stopping you from accepting that? What would you need to surrender to possess eternal life? I don't think that God needs your stuff. And that's where the fear comes. When you say to people, okay, sell something, give the money to the poor, we think right away God's after our stuff. God doesn't need our stuff. Though those mini storages, and look at me, I got two buildings out there full of my stuff. It's my stuff mart. We've got to have stuff. That's what I call Walmart now, stuff mart. I'm going to buy stuff. I don't think God needs our stuff. His love for you drives him. It drives him. It pushes him to seek you. In a few minutes, we're going to watch a music video called Reckless Love, that song that I've talked about a few times. And then I'm going to read something about it. All his efforts, all his suffering, all his heart's desire is that you would live forever with him in paradise.
Amen.
Everything he does is for that purpose. Yesterday at the funeral, I said, all God wants from you is for you to believe that he gave his life for your sin. In the passage we studied, there were few words we need to pay close attention to. After he told the rich young man what to do, he said, follow me. Follow me. We tend to look at that as here and now, that meaning follow his direction. Only do what he wants you to do. And follow me in the direction I have for your life. And that's true. But there's more than that. It's not just about what you're doing right, what you're doing wrong, and where you're going, and what. It's more than that. In John 14:1, he says, do not let your hearts be troubled. You believe in God, believe in me. My Father's house has many rooms. If that were not so, would I have told you that I'm going to prepare a place for you? And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come back and take you, that you may also be where I am. You see, he's not just saying, follow me today and follow me tomorrow. The young man wants to know where eternal life is. He's saying, follow me back home. Follow me to heaven. Follow my example. My love for people. My love for the lost. I walked in a conversation, and I didn't really get part of it, but I think Pierre was talking to someone about Mother Teresa. That's an example. Just do what I... and follow me to heaven. Mark, can you fire this thing up?
You leave the 99 to find the one every time. So before I spoke miracle word. Before I spoke a word, you were singing over me. And you have been so, so good to me. Yes, you have, yes, you have. For I took a breath, you breathed your life in me. You have been so, so kind. Come on, every voice, lift it all. Hear all the overwhelming, never-ending, reckless love of God. And oh, it chases me down, fights till I'm found, leaves the 99. And I couldn't earn it, and I don't deserve it. Still you away. Oh, the overwhelming, never-ending, reckless love of God. There's nothing like it. Whoa. So when I was your foe, your foe, still your love fought for me. Yeah, it did. And you have been so, so good to me. When I felt no words, you paid it all for me. Yeah, you did. Yeah, you did. And you have been so, so
said, many have asked me for clarity on the phrase reckless love. Many have wondered why I use a negative word to describe God. I've taken some time to write out my thoughts here. I hope it brings answers to your questions. But more than that, I hope it brings you into an encounter with the wildness of his love. When I use the phrase the reckless love of God, I'm not saying that God himself is reckless. I am, however, saying the way he loves is, in many regards, quite so. What I mean is this. He is utterly unconcerned with the consequences of his actions with regard to his own safety, comfort, or well-being. His love isn't crafty or slick. It is not cunning or shrewd. In fact, all things considered, it is quite childlike, and might I even suggest sometimes downright ridiculous. His love bankrupted heaven for you. His love doesn't consider himself first. His love isn't selfish or self-serving. He doesn't wonder what he'll gain or lose by putting himself out there. He simply gives himself away on the off chance that one of us might look back at him and offer ourselves in return. His love leaves the 99 to find the one every time. To many practical adults, this is a foolish concept. But what if he loses the 99 in search of the one? What if finding the one lost sheep is, and always will be, supremely important? His love isn't cautious. No, it's love that sent his own son to die a gruesome death on a cross. There's no plan B with the love of God. He gives his heart so completely, so preposterously, that if I refuse, most would consider it irreparably broken. Yet he gave himself away. The recklessness of his love is seen most clearly in this. It gets him hurt over and over. Make no mistake, our sins pain his heart. And 70 times 7 is not a lot of time, is a lot of times you have your heart broken, yet he opens up and allows us in every time. His love saw you when you hated him. When all logic said, they'll reject me, he said, I don't care if it kills me. I'm laying down my heart on the line. To get personal, his love saw me, a broken down kid with regret as deep as the ocean. My innocence and youth poured out like water. Yet, he saw fit to use me for his kingdom because he's just that kind. I didn't earn it, and I sure as heck don't deserve it. But he's just that good. Oh, the overwhelming, never-ending, reckless love of God. And now you know why I wanted to bring this song to you. You see, to answer the young man's question, what do I need to do? You need to accept it. You need to accept it. And you need to give up hunting other stuff. Because my love is bigger than it all.